And welcome to Bruz International, the English-speaking show here on Bruz. It's great to have you with us for this special end-of-year edition where we're playing some of our favourite reports that we made for you throughout the year. Now, as you know, if you watch Bruz International occasionally, we love to eat and go out, but we also love to walk and take you to some interesting places around the city.
Ik vind het heel belangrijk om alle facetten van een stad eerlijk te vertellen. Want veel gidsen moeten het altijd zo... Nee, het is hier allemaal schoon en we gaan een andere straat. Nee, ik vind de ruwheid van een stad is heel belangrijk. Dat bepaalt de identiteit ook deels. En we mogen dat niet allemaal zomaar van de kaart vegen. Ik schrijf boeken over de geschiedenis grotendeels van steden. En nu heb ik een nieuw boek uit van Brussel. En dat gaat eigenlijk heel specifiek over hoe dat Brussel er vroeger uitzag en hoe dat het er vandaag aan toe gaat. Er zijn 50 foto's voor en na. Dus 50 oude archieffoto's, die denk ik gaan zoeken overal in verschillende soorten archieven. Ik heb zelf ook een heel groot privéarchief. Ik ben zo'n maniak die zo'n jouw foto's en postkaartjes bijhoudt. Ik vind dat heerlijk. En daaruit is dat eigenlijk gegroeid om boeken daarover te maken. Ik ben een zeer melancholisch persoon, absoluut. De wereldexpositie van 1958, ja, die heb ik duidelijk niet meegemaakt. Maar als ik die beelden zie en dergelijke, ik kan mij helemaal inleven over hoe dat vroeger moet geweest zijn. Mijn mama is jammer genoeg een paar jaar geleden gestorven, maar die is 98 geworden. En die heeft mij zoveel kleine anekdotes verteld over de steden. En ja, dat blijft nazinderen. En daar zijn die boeken eigenlijk uit voortgekomen.
We are in the Aegidium in Saint-Gilles. It's an amazing building which used to be like a glorious theater and ballroom in Brussels in the beginning of the 20th century. And now it's been decades that the place is abandoned, and it's wonderful to see. And I have the keys, so sometimes I bring people inside of this place. So the project is called Les Visites de Mon Voisin, and the idea was to make alternative guided tours, but just for our friends at the beginning. So I used to give appointments to people in the night or in special places, and it was very confidential. And then it became not famous, but the concept had its success, and now it's a real project. But the idea originally is to make tours in the city. I try to show to the people the chaotic urbanism of Brussels and to have a vision, quite political actually, of the city.
So we are here in the philosophical garden of the Erasmus House in Brussels. Erasmus of Rotterdam, the philosopher, lived here in this house in 1521. The Erasmus House is a museum dedicated to the history of Renaissance humanism. First of all, it's a really acute appetite for knowledge, so a love for books. It's a philosophy that aims at the fulfillment of human nature, and that's why I love it, because this is this belief that the human being is good, it's even perfectible thanks to education and culture. And Erasmus really believed in this, that culture and education are central in his thought.
Mockmeister is like a two-headed alter ego of me and my girlfriend. And what we do is like post-mortem fairy tales. So we create some kind of a fairy tale universe in which post-mortem, so taxidermy is a most important feature because we consider like taxidermy as a form of art. We always try to dress up our animals as if they were also part of the, you know, they can be a fairy tale character as well. So it's also the connection between the main character, let's say the persona, and the animal is very important. We always try to take care of the animal. We will never look grotesque. The masks as such can look grotesque, but there's always this comforting behavior towards the animal.
The problem with domestic violence is that it's kind of incorporated in our society. Almost everyone knows someone that has been beaten by their partner. In many ways, you could say that the most unsafe place for a woman to be is very often in her own home. That's where she gets exposed to violence mostly. And that's a kind of a terrible thing to understand. I'm not interested in creating some kind of spectacular violent situation. It's to put the audience to be a voyeuristic, a viewer of violence, to understand how it works. Very often when I'm having conversations or maybe artist talks about this piece, there's someone telling that there's of course also men being exposed to domestic violence, but the numbers are ridiculously low in comparison. It's so deeply ingrown in the heteronormative relationship, and it's also a little bit protected by the structure that we live in. You know, very often you could hear people say, but you know, yeah, he's jealous because he loves you so much. I have a close family member that was exposed to very hard domestic violence, so I know the structure, I know how it works. Very often people are not talking about it, even if they know someone is getting beaten. They are not really there to say anything, and I think this is a piece that should open up for a conversation.
Next, here at Bruz International, we really love and appreciate art and take any chance we can to sit down with artists and hear how they're making a living and doing what they love.
I'm not an expat. I think that's one of the biggest things that, if you want to insult me, call me an expat. I am an immigrant. I did not specifically choose to move to Europe. I missed my plane, so I was stuck here. I lived illegally for a number of years. And when I found Brussels through playing concerts, and when I met Brussels, I just fell in love. In a way, I feel like I'm living the Belgian dream, because, you know, here I'm Prince Carnival. I'm king of the, you know, St. Sebastian Schatterbeek Archery Guild. Pottery, it's like my meditation. The kind of wheel that I use makes very little sound, but there's still just this like low hum. And depending on the form that you make, sometimes the form amplifies the motor, and so you'll have this kind of monotone singing that will come out of your piece before it's finished.
Je m'appelle Hadassa Ngamba, je viens de la République démocratique du Congo et je suis artiste visuelle. J'habite à Saint-Gilles, c'est un quartier où il y a beaucoup d'artistes. J'aime bien comment est-ce qu'ici, par exemple, les jardins sont placés. Ça n'existait pas au Congo, ça, parce que nous, les jardins, c'est très grand. Mais ici, les jardins sont souvent derrière les maisons, un peu cachés. Ici, on a l'impression dans la ville qu'il n'y a pas de classe sociale, et pourtant ça existe, mais on a la possibilité de rencontrer tout le monde dans une terrasse. Mes cheveux, je l'utilise pour faire des œuvres artistiques. Déjà, je l'ai utilisé à Lubumbashi, par exemple, avec des tresses longues qui mesuraient 66 cm. Je me suis promenée pendant 2 semaines dans la ville, et après, je me suis fait photographier par un artiste.
I only draw women because I'm trying to put focus on women in society and everywhere. It's definitely feminist-based art, even though you can't immediately see it. So I use Renaissance and Baroque paintings, actually, that I transfer into drawings with a very contemporary technique. I'm born in Germany. My father is from the former Yugoslavia. My mom is from South Korea. So already that gave me a little bit more input, or like, yeah, I went to South Korea when I was very small, and my grandma lived in very different circumstances. Like, she didn't have running water, and things like that. So you start realizing that people and countries are very different, but in the end, they're not. But I think that's one of the things that I very much enjoy here. You hear so many different languages, you meet people from different countries, and you know, they all have different stories, but in the end, we're often brought here for the same reasons. It's always funny how, when people ask, how did you become an artist? Because I feel like I did not become an artist. I've always been an artist. It's just like I've always enjoyed drawing and making things and creating, and it's such a, it's amazing. Like you make something that doesn't exist before, and hopefully it's something beautiful.
Nací en Uruguay, llegué a Bélgica a la edad de 17 años porque tenía mi padre aquí y siempre fui apasionado por el arte y mi padre tenía una librería y yo comencé a mirar todos los libros de arte que había en la librería y fui descubriendo casi por un camino solitario, digamos, todo el arte moderno que no conocía tan bien en Sudamérica. Después comencé a trabajar, estudié la herrería, me apasionaba el trabajo manual y trabajaba el hierro. Y después comencé a ir a la escuela de arte por la noche como un placer. Y eso comenzó a tomar proporciones cada vez más grandes. Y un día decidí pasar al arte completamente y comencé con mi trabajo de escultura y hace 33 años que estoy ocupado a hacer la escultura. Comencé a crear un personaje que tenga una personalidad universal. Ese personaje me tomó una importancia mayor en mi trabajo. Hago otras cosas, pinto, dibujo, grabo, pero es mi escultura es mi personaje. Inventé un individuo un poco universal. Yo los llamo mis hijos y ellos viajan más que yo.
And finally, as well as art here at Bruss International, we love music. We just couldn't imagine a life without music. And we love every opportunity we have as well to catch up with musicians and artists and people who also, like us, love music.
I started to tap dance when I was 22 and I was at the time studying politics and I went to Erasmus program to Liverpool and there was a flyer tap dance class and that was my very first experience, my first class. After my first class, I was really excited. I was super passionate about tap dancing. I was watching lots of old musicals, lots of Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers. I was trying to figure out what they are doing and learn by myself. I come from Czech Republic. And I moved to Belgium 10 years ago because I did audition to a dance group. It was no tap dancing group at the time. It was Lindy Hop, solo jazz, and they took me in. So I arrived originally to Ghent. I like to dance to jazz music, lots of swing music, so 30s, 40s, 50s jazz, Lester Young, Teddy Wilson, Count Basie, all those big stars.
Emotions are very much difficult to put in words, not only for children, but also for adults. Sound reaches places in our body and brain that otherwise are very difficult to reach. I come from Lithuania. I came here to study flute in Conservatory of Brussels. Then later on, I heard about existence of music therapy in Leuven. So then I went to study there after studying, learning Dutch. Doing my internship here in UZ Brussel in the psychiatric afdeling for infants, adolescenten and kinderen. Children, when they come to this room, they are really excited to see all the instruments. It's a very motivating medium for them, also for the teenagers. And I can be then with someone in this experience together. I can support them and feel together what they feel. I've seen so much evolution in so many kids. It's really helpful.
J'ai écouté l'orgue pour la première fois. Seulement, j'avais 17 ans au Japon, dans une grande salle. Et j'étais très émue et j'ai senti mon cœur rentrer en résonance et vibrer avec l'orgue. À l'époque, je voulais devenir une pianiste comme ma mère. Mais voilà, j'ai rencontré l'orgue. C'est quoi la différence entre l'orgue et le piano? Le piano est un instrument à cordes. L'orgue est un instrument à vent. Il y a des souffris, des tuyaux et des jeux. On dit les stations. C'est-à-dire qu'on va choisir le son. On va écouter et puis on va sentir ah, si on a besoin, on a envie de plus ajouter quelque chose. On va ajouter plus de jeux.
It would have been strange for me not to want to play the piano. It was the natural evolution of my growing up.
Well, my daughter was born in an ambiance, in an environment of music. And, you know, actually, since they are in the belly, they listen to music all the time. And when she was 3 years old, she said, "Mommy, I would like to take piano lessons with you." And I said, "Okay, piano lessons, yes, but not with me, with my mother."
I enjoy so much giving my lessons and playing with them. And when I say playing, it's playing and playing the piano.
The amount of hours that we spend together is so unusual for a grandmother and a granddaughter.
It was a natural thing at my place because we all make music. We are the whole time listening to music.
Learning how to play the music is also a hugely introspective work, I think. It's very therapeutical. You're basically learning to transmit emotions, so you have to learn how to understand your own emotions as well.
We transmit the ones to the others, and it happens without even thinking. Mm. And this is what's wonderful. It's that we don't calculate, oh, I'm going to teach them. No, it just happens naturally.
Afraid for this special end of year edition of Bras International. We hope that you enjoyed it. All that's left to say from me and from all the team here at Bras International is Happy New Year. Have a great time, enjoy yourself, and we see you very soon here on Bras International.